Good evening. It is a pleasure to be here, and let me first thank the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Royal Society of London. I'm getting some feedback here. And the Carnegie Institution for Science for the opportunity to tell you a bit about our universe that is indeed stranger than we thought. The last century, when we thought about the universe, what we thought about was a universe that was filled with stars. We knew about the planets in our own solar system, and we thought it was a universe that didn't change with time. The stars were fixed stars. We saw their motions, their diurnal motions, but we didn't think of the universe as either expanding or contracting. A century later, we've learned that the universe is a dynamic universe. It's evolving, it's changing with time. It's filled not only with stars, but it's filled with galaxies composed of stars. It's filled with exotic objects like black holes, and it's filled with matter that bears little resemblance to the matter that we know about, and it's filled with dark energy. And it's a century in which we made a number of discoveries in cosmology, and I'm going to concentrate on three this evening: the discovery of the expanding universe, the discovery of learning about the presence of dark matter in the universe, and the discovery of the acceleration of the expansion. So let me start with the first discovery, the expansion, and that, as we know, much was discovered by Edwin Hubble, after whom the Hubble Space Telescope is named. I'm just looking to see if there's a laser pointer here. Is there? Does anybody know? I don't think there is. Okay. The history of cosmology in the 20th century really is inextricably intertwined with the history of the Carnegie Institution of Science itself. And Andrew Carnegie had a vision that if you hired the exceptional scientist, the exceptional individual, and gave that individual, he said, individual man, the exceptional man, hope he wouldn't be too disappointed that a century later the definition is broadened. And if you gave them resources, if you gave them a laboratory, you gave them the apparatus to do science, then interesting discoveries would follow. And George Ellery Hale, who was the first director of the observatories of the Carnegie Institution, had a vision of his own, which was that if you built large telescopes with reflecting mirrors, then you would make discoveries in astronomy. That's where they would come. And Hale came out to Pasadena in 1903. You can see him up at the left, surveying at Mount Wilson, just north of Los Angeles. And Hale was fond of the saying, make no little plans. It was a quote from the American architect Daniel Burnham, and I think the rest of it went something to the effect, they have no magic to stir men's blood. And Hale certainly made no little plans. And he started off at Mount Wilson, first building a solar telescope. He was interested in the sun, and in fact, he was the astronomer who discovered that there were magnetic fields on the sun. And then he moved to the construction of a 60-inch telescope. And this is the telescope where a Carnegie astronomer at the time by the name of Harlow Shapley discovered that our sun is not the center of the universe. And that's where the sun had resided since Copernicus in 1543 had shown that the Earth was not the center of the universe. And Shapley showed that the sun is actually located about two-thirds of the way out in a disk, a plane of what we now know as our own Milky Way galaxy. So that was an extraordinary discovery that came of the first telescopes at Mount Wilson. And then Hale went on to build the 100-inch telescope, and in fact began construction even before the 60-inch was completed, which is quite remarkable. And the 100-inch is where Edwin Hubble made his discoveries about the expanding universe. But before Hale was done, he also was the driving force in building the 200-inch telescope at Mount Palomar near San Diego. And here's Edwin Hubble, who used the telescope, the 100-inch telescope, to study a class of objects that are known as nebulae. Here's one of the nebulae shown on a glass photographic plate that he took. These photographic plates were the detectors in use at the time when the 100-inch became operational. And this black fuzzy thing is what was known as a nebula. This is a negative, so the stars here are actually dark rather than bright. And these objects had been cataloged for a couple hundred years by astronomers. Many of them had beautiful spiral features. And the question was, were these objects that might be swirling around regions of gas and dust that were collecting under gravity to form new stars in the Milky Way? Or were they, like the Milky Way itself and other objects, other nebulae, at greater distances? And up in the far right, in the red box, you can see that Hubble marked on this photographic plate, he wrote VAR! Exclamation mark. And he was excited to find a type of variable, VAR stands for variable, a star called a Cepheid, which is an object that allows astronomers to measure distances. I'll get to that in a moment. And what Hubble was able to realize was that this object was, in fact, well beyond the confines of our own Milky Way galaxy. We know it now to be about 2 million light years distant from us. And what that means is that light, which we know travels at 186,000 miles per second, so if it circled the Earth, it would circle it 7 times in 1 second. This object is 2 million light years away from us, and it's a nearby object. It's all relative. So it would take 2 million years traveling at the speed of light for light to reach us from this object. And Hubble went on to make these measurements in many different galaxies, and he was able to show that if you made a plot of the velocity shown on the left-hand axis here. He forgot the seconds. He actually published this. That's real. This is published in the National Academy of Sciences in 1929. And I suspect they knew that velocities were in kilometers per second then, but got left off. Velocity increasing upwards and distance to the right. And what he noticed was that there was a correlation between how fast a galaxy is moving, these were measurements made by others, and his own distance measurements. So this was quite a spectacular, two discoveries. One, that there are galaxies in addition to our own. There are about 100 billion such galaxies in our observable universe, and within galaxies like our Milky Way, there are about 100 billion stars within each galaxy. So there are other galaxies. And not only are there galaxies, but the galaxies are participating in an overall expansion of the universe, and they're actually being, universes being stretched apart, and the galaxies are participating in the overall expansion of the universe. So quite a phenomenal discovery. Here's Edwin Hubble observing at the 100 inch with his well-known pipe, and this is his lowly telescope assistant who's helping him observe at the telescope. And I suppose it's because Hubble was so well-known that he got to have a fairly well-known telescope assistant also. But I suspect that Einstein never actually observed a telescope, nor did Hubble do theory. And in fact, Hubble didn't actually believe that the universe was expanding, probably till his death. He was not certain that the empirical result actually meant that the universe was expanding. But it was the integration of Einstein's general theory of relativity which describes gravity, that described, based on Hubble's observational results, this linear relationship between velocity and distance, that the universe must have had a beginning. There would have been a time in the past, if it was expanding now, when the universe would have been hot and dense. And these two, the theory and the observations, led to our picture of a Big Bang universe with a hot, fiery explosion. About 13 billion years ago. And so here schematically showing a universe that has an origin, a Big Bang origin, we now can measure the surface here about 380,000 years after the Big Bang, where we see the remnant radiation, the cool microwave photons from the original Big Bang explosion, and a period very early in the universe where there was a very rapid acceleration. Astronomers refer to that as an inflationary epoch, where the tiny, small fluctuations due to quantum noise in the early universe were stretched to form the structure that we see today, and I'll return to that later. And there's also a region between the surface about 400,000 years after the Big Bang, where we see the remnant radiation, and today, that astronomers refer to as the Dark Ages, about which we know almost nothing, and which some of the facilities that are on the drawing board now, and in construction or just about to be in construction will study the earliest moments in the universe. So here's the Hubble Space Telescope after Hubble, is Edwin Hubble, named after Edwin Hubble, and seen from the space station. This is a telescope that orbits about 600 kilometers above the Earth, orbits every 90 minutes, and for the first time allowed astronomers to get a glimpse of the sky unperturbed by the atmosphere, where there's turbulence that smears the images that are coming to us from distant objects. And here are some of the images that have come from Hubble. You can see up in the upper left many of the galaxies, this galaxy here, a spiral, not unlike the Milky Way, if we were to be able to get out of the Milky Way and look back on it face on. Many of them are in couples. They're actually in the process of merging together. We see examples of those. Hubble has studied just about every kind of object we know about in the universe. This is a cluster of stars. There are regions of gas and dust in our own Milky Way where actual stars are being formed today. And studies of dark energy, studies of the expansion of the universe. I could go on, but I won't get to the rest of my talk, and so I will go on. The Cepheid variables. This is another topic that Hubble allowed us to make great progress with, and this is one of the projects that I've been involved in, is to measure the distances to galaxies, as Edwin Hubble started out to do, but what turned out to be rather difficult with the technology of his day. So these stars are pulsating. They're changing in their brightness, and they do so at a very regular rate. And the rate at which they're changing in their brightness turns out to be related to how bright the star is. So the very luminous stars change more slowly than the less luminous, smaller stars that are pulsating more rapidly. And there's actually a unique correspondence between the rate at which they're changing their brightness and their brightness. So if you can measure nearby objects, for which we have geometrical techniques to determine distances, then you can compare these Cepheid variables at varying distances and essentially chart out the distance scale of the universe, which is what we've done with Hubble and also more recently with the sister satellite to Hubble, the Spitzer telescope, that operates in the mid-infrared, very long wavelengths. This is a cover Time magazine, March 1995. I thought it was appropriate. It's all about time. When did the universe begin? And this was one of the galaxies that we observed with Hubble. This is the galaxy Messier 100, and it was the first galaxy that we used Hubble after it was repaired to find Cepheids in. And here's Hubble's original chart of velocity compared to distance. And if you notice this first tick mark here, that's where Hubble's data lie. And today we can make measurements of distances out to greatly vaster distances, and we can use many different techniques to measure the distances and then compare them and understand what the uncertainties in each of the techniques are. And so our group, using the Hubble Space Telescope, was able to estimate an age of the universe of about 14 billion years, and that's resolved a debate that had been ongoing. We didn't know the age or the size of the universe to better than a factor of 2. And that's subsequently been confirmed by a number of other groups. So the second discovery I wanted to talk about is the existence of dark matter in the universe. And here is Vera Rubin, who has been at the Department of Terrestrial Magnetism, Carnegie's department here in Washington, DC. And the existence of dark matter started to be inferred, actually going back to the 1930s, with some observations of Fritz Wicki at Caltech. And then there were observations by another Carnegie astronomer, Horace Babcock, who was a director of the observatories. And actually in 1939, he made the first measurements of the velocity of stars in the Andromeda galaxy, the same galaxy that Hubble discovered Cepheids in. And so this is just showing what happens, the velocity of stars and gas in the outer part of the Andromeda galaxy as you move away from the center of the galaxy. and notice that the velocities increase. And that was completely ignored because it wasn't expected and nobody knew how to explain it. And Vera came along in the 1970s, and what was expected was that the velocities of stars and the gas in galaxies would fall off in the outer parts, in the same way as we observe the velocities of planets in our solar system to fall off with distance. But instead, essentially every galaxy that Vera and her collaborator Kent Ford measured either increased or was flat. So what it was signaling was that there was matter in the outer regions of these galaxies, perhaps, that these stars would have flown away long ago. They wouldn't have remained bound to the galaxy moving at those speeds if there wasn't additional matter there to hold them there. Now, a number of other explanations were devised, but the evidence kept increasing, not only Fritzwicki's measurements in the Coma Cluster, but measurements of velocities of other galaxies. Galaxies tend to like to be located near other galaxies, they cluster, and the velocities of these galaxies, as people were measuring them, again, far higher than they should have been if there wasn't more mass there. They would have flown away, they would have moved long ago from the region of the cluster. And then as it became possible to measure very hot gas in these clusters of galaxies, very high temperatures, perhaps 100 million degrees, that gas should have evaporated if there wasn't more mass there that was holding it and binding it to the cluster. Similarly, Einstein had predicted that around a massive object, space would bend and you would see bending of light. Here's an example of light that's coming through a distant cluster, a distant object that is actually being bent. You can see these arcs in this image, again indicating that there's much more mass there than you would add up based on the luminous matter in galaxies alone. So the conclusion turns out to be that only about 4% of the composition of the universe is ordinary matter. Most of the matter in the universe is dark. We don't see it. It doesn't emit light or electromagnetic radiation. Here are more examples of gravitational lensing. So what could this dark matter be? Lots of ideas. Could they be rocks? Could they be planets? Could they be remnants of old stars that aren't shining? Could it be gas? Could it be compact objects? Could it be black holes, dust? And in the 1980s, many groups searched for what could be the remnants of this dark matter in what we knew about, and all failed. And the only option that was left standing was an as yet undiscovered particle, a particle that was formed soon after the Big Bang, and I'll get to those in a moment. Quickly then, what we see as observers when we look out into the universe is a universe filled with galaxies, filled with stars. It's lumpy, it forms this large cosmic web. Galaxies are in these long filaments, clusters, and it's full of stars, full of galaxies, full of clusters. Now, Sir Martin Rees is a theorist. This is the theorist view of the universe. And it turns out that on the largest scale, the universe is homogeneous and isotropic, and it's full of dark matter and dark energy, and this is a savvy enough audience to know that's not an actual image of dark matter. So in the interest of time, I'm leaving Martin some time, because I think you may be touching on large-scale structure. I'm going to move on from this, and I will say only that this universe that we observe, it turns out that galaxies, what we see in luminous matter, is only about 1/6 of what there is in dark matter. There are simulations now, numerical simulations, where there are literally billions of particles in computers that are used to simulate the growth of the structure in the universe that we see today. So what is the dark matter? The best idea at the current time is that it is a relic from the early universe, formed soon after the Big Bang, left over from the Big Bang, and it interacts only via gravity. That is, there's no electromagnetic, no other forces that we're aware of. It interacts via gravity, so that we see its effects, we see the motions of stars that are being perturbed by the existence of this other matter.
And this is something that there are many experiments around the world. People are looking in underground laboratories, searching for the particles that might be these dark matter candidates. And detectors that are made of elements like germanium and silicon. They're deep underground because there could be other noise sources. They're shielded by lead. And you're looking for this very faint signal from what could be these weakly interacting massive particles. There are also experiments in space. There's a Fermi satellite that's looking for possible dark matter, the Large Hadron Collider, which is between France and Switzerland, a particle accelerator that is accelerating particles at very high velocities and smashing them, and also looking for the existence of potential dark matter candidates. Okay. We haven't found the dark matter. One thing I will say is that I think the next decade is going to be very exciting in our field. You're either going to find the dark matter or not. And so I think we're hoping very much to find it, but we'll have to understand what it means if we actually don't find the candidate. Acceleration of the universe. This is a discovery that was made in 1998 and 1999 by two groups, two independent groups, and using a type of object called supernovae, a particular kind of supernova that is the result of the evolution of a mass of a star that's actually in a double star system. One of the stars is more evolved, and the companion star, mass from the companion star is falling onto this companion. It's called a white dwarf. And the matter is falling onto the white dwarf from the other star, and eventually you exceed a certain mass and that white dwarf explodes. And the explosion is so bright that you can actually see it over most of the observable universe. And in fact, the supernovae themselves can be as bright as an entire galaxy. And so they actually look more like that when you're looking at a distant galaxy. You can see the arrow is pointing to a small dot, but still bright enough to measure. And when astronomers have made these measurements, and many of us at Carnegie have also been involved in these measurements, and as you make them at farther and farther distances, you can chart, assuming that these objects don't vary too much with time, and empirically we don't see that they do, you can measure the expansion rate of the universe, and what has been found is the universe is speeding up, it's accelerating. We live in an accelerating universe. So the reason for this, the current time is not well understood. We don't know the nature of the dark energy that's causing the expansion, but we do know that it makes up most of the composition of the universe. And just to give you some sense, the density of this dark energy is about 10 to the minus 30 grams per cubic centimeter. And just in case that doesn't mean anything to you, the density of water is about 1 gram per cubic centimeter. And if you don't like metric, and if you don't like scientific notation, you need the zeros in front. It's a small number. And that's in pounds per cubic inch. And essentially what appears to be is there is energy in the vacuum of space. And the reason that it's so important is the volume of space is so large. But this is not something that we can detect in the laboratory. So it's something that has come out of astronomy. It's a discovery that only could have been made, most likely, by discovering it applied to the universe. So this has been referred to as one of the biggest mysteries in science. We really don't understand the fundamental nature of what is causing the universe to be stretched apart. Essentially, it's being pulled apart. And this just summarizing now, we don't know what 95% of the universe is made of at this point. So I just quickly want to just say a few words about what's on the horizon, because there's some very exciting things coming along. The successor to the Hubble Space Telescope is called the James Webb Space Telescope. It's a 6.5 meter space that is due to be launched in 2018. And unlike Hubble, which is orbiting the Earth, and it's about 350 miles, up, it's, and here comparing the Earth-Moon distance, which is about a quarter of a million miles, the James Webb Space Telescope is going to be about 1 million miles from the Earth. So it won't be serviced like Hubble. And it's going to, we don't think, I hope not. It's going to open up these sunshades you can see here that are going to protect the telescope and keep it cooled. And the mirror, which is composed of 18 individual fragments, will actually open up and be deployed in space. This is a telescope that will let us study some of the earliest moments in the universe and these dark ages that I referred to earlier in the talk. And I also wanted to say something about a telescope that's being planned from the ground. There are three of these now in the planning stages. And this is a telescope where I've been leading this effort along with a number of institutions. I should say that in the audience this evening is the president of the University of Arizona, one of our partners. We've got the director of the Center for Astrophysics at Smithsonian and Harvard here this evening also. It's a big collaboration. It's international now. We've got Australia and South Korea. It's a 25-meter telescope, and it's going to have 10 times the resolution of the Hubble Space Telescope. It's really quite spectacular. And here, just to show you, this is an actual design drawing, one of the early stages of the design. There's 7 mirrors in this telescope, each one of which is over 27 feet in diameter. It's incredible technology. These mirrors are being manufactured underneath the football stadium at the University of Arizona. Not what the football stadium was designed to do, but it's really good use of the football stadium. And we've actually made 3 of these mirrors now, our colleagues at the University of Arizona. We've promised not to throw them into the mirror, into the telescope, the way we're showing in the video. We'll treat them more carefully. But we will ship these to Chile in the Andes Mountains, where the Carnegie Institution owns a site at Las Campanas, home to our current 6.5-meter Magellan telescopes. So our plan is to complete the first stage of the telescope with 4 mirrors and get early science in the year. We'll commission this in 2020 and begin taking data in 2021, and we're about to start construction this summer. So it's a tremendously exciting project, and we're just about to launch it in construction. So let me conclude and just say, our universe has really turned out to be quite extraordinary. It is stranger than we think. It's vast, it's expanding, it's filled with exotic objects and new kinds of matter and energy. And I would venture that it is very unlikely to be through surprising us. So thank you.